नमस्कार। आज संस्थान अपना 15वां स्थापना दिवस मना रहा है। यह एक विशेष दिन है जब हम इस संस्थान की स्थापना तथा इसके संस्थापकों के योगदान का स्मरण करते हैं। आज हिंदी दिवस भी है, इसलिए सुबह राजभाषा प्रतिज्ञा लेते हुए हमने इस दिन की शुरुआत की है। हम आप सबको हिंदी दिवस एवं 15वां स्थापना दिवस की शुभकामनाएं देते हुए आज का कार्यक्रम शुरू करते हैं। September 14 is a special day for ISD as the institute is celebrating its 15th foundation day. It's a day to express our gratitude to the faculty, staff, students, alumni and other stakeholders who have helped us in this 15 years of journey. Honorable Chief Guest Sri A.S. Kiran Kumar, former Secretary Department of Space and Chairman ISRO, Honorable Chancellor of ISD Dr. B.N. Suresh, Directors of ISRO Center Units, technical experts of various industries, Director IST as well as Director of VSSC Sri S. Somnath, Dr. Vivin Krishnamurthy, Registrar IST, Deans, members of faculty, officers, staff, and dear students. A very good morning to all. Hum is karyakram ki shuruaat Ish Vandana se karte hain. I invite Kumari Kartika, M.Tech Department of Chemistry for invocation.
जगदधीश रात्रियुं शशांग तारकंगलुं पगलु मार्क बिंबवं निरन्य मेघ जालवं मृग कदंब पक्षि वृक्ष पुष्प शलभगंगलुं மிகவில் நின்றே வைபவங்கள் வாழ்த்திடுன்னு தெய்வமே மிகவில் நின்றே வைபவங்கள் வாழ்த்திடுன்னு தெய்வமே
धन्यवाद कार्तिका। हमारे संस्थान में अपने प्रथम कुलाधिपति डॉक्टर एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम के पावन स्मृति में डॉक्टर एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम व्याख्यान माला का संस्थापन किया गया है। आज इस व्याख्यान माला के 7वीं व्याख्यान का आयोजन किया जा रहा है। 15वां स्थापना दिवस समारोह एवं 7वां डॉक्टर एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम व्याख्यान में आप सबका हार्दिक स्वागत है। As part of IST Foundation Day celebrations, the institute has hosted a variety of activities such as outreach program for school students, alumni program, IST ISRO interface meet and IST industry meet, as well as Hindi Day celebrations. And in the morning, we had the first session of the IST industry meet. Now we will have the 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture series was instituted in IST in the fond memory of his first chancellor, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. I feel privileged to welcome you all to the 15th IST Foundation Day celebrations and 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture. अपने स्वागत भाषण के लिए डॉक्टर वाईविन कृष्णमूर्ति कुलसचिव आईएसटी को सादर आमंत्रित करूंगी। मैं नाउ इनवाइट डॉक्टर वाईविन कृष्णमूर्ति रजिस्ट्रार आईएसटी टू डिलीवर द वेलकम एड्रेस।
सो गुड मॉर्निंग टू एवरीवन। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम आवर चीफ गेस्ट टुडे श्री किरण कुमार सर, former chairman ISRO and secretary department of space and presently member space commission and our chancellor Dr. B.N. Suresh and different dignitaries who joined on this webinar series of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture from different locations, and also my deans and faculty and staff and officers. It's a privilege to be part of the celebrations of IAST, and especially for me, because I completed now 3 years on this day when I joined here. And it's a unique opportunity to be at IAST with the young minds and also the professors who has very interesting ideas and putting through. Sir, as already briefly mentioned by the comparer, that we had the celebration started on 11th, which we have mentioned to you. I have started off with a series from IAST alumni, which has actually conducted a program of lecture series by eminent people like Professor V. Radhakrishnan, former professor of IIT Madras, and also guest speakers from University of Liverpool, then Superior, and also the CEO of Cell Propulsion. And then there is an Ankesh Mishra Memorial General Quiz Competition. This also was being conducted every year. That's on 11th and 12th morning. And on 12th, we had a IAST at schools. This is an KAP from Kanyakumari. In fact, they select students, around 50, conducting many competitions, and they bring to IAST every year. But last year and this year, we had to do on a webinar series, and 8 standard students, and they do a very good job of the comprehensively writing what the speakers make, and then they bring out as a booklet. And it's a very interesting comprehension. At such a young age, the students are picked up and then bringing up. And there's a special lectures have been given there by our colleagues on electric vehicles, future of transportation, search for habitable worlds, seeing atoms, the story of microscopes. And also director, Mr. Somnath, also addressed the students. And I also gave a talk on space applications. Sir, actually this time Alumni and has conducted a competition looking at the IAST's role in making India into an emerging space power, because we are celebrating the 75th year of independence. So that was a topic, and there's a good participation. And within a short time, they came out a contest with the guidelines, and the contest results are also elaborated. They gave an opportunity for the students too, and it has come very interesting about how IAST is contributing to the overall system. And we have yesterday we had the ISRO centers, because there's a new one, sir, which we added this year as part of the celebrations, is ISRO IAST interface. So all the center directors participated, and our colleagues, the HODs, have presented on the research activities which are going, the labs which have been put through, and what they are looking forward. And each of the center directors also have detailed what they expect. And what one of the two is mostly on interdisciplinary type of a research, which they look forward and looking beyond what ISRO does. Certain programs, we have to think about it and start. These are the two major things which has come out of that interface. And today morning, we had a kickoff session with the first session with all the industries under three groups, which has been made as aerospace technology and materials, sensors, payloads, and small satellites, and space applications. Each of the sessions, on an average, more than 20 industries participated. There's a good deliberations. The outcome of it, sir, in the evening, afternoon, on the plenary session, it will be brought out and presented to under plenary session chaired by our Chancellor, Honorable Chancellor, Dr. B.N. Suresh. And there also will be three presentations. One by Colonel Shankar will be talking about the perspective from industry and what are the opportunities for industry, our D. Radhakrishnan from NSAL, and Sam Dayal Dev about opportunities in ISRO. These are the three talks, and we have a summation. So at this juncture, sir, it is also my proud privilege to introduce you to the gathering here. Sri A.S. Kiran Kumar is Vikram Sarabhai Professor at ISRO Bangalore and member of the Space Commission Government of India. He is also a member of Governing Council, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. During 2015 to 2018, he has served as Secretary, Department of Space, and Chairman, Indian Space Research Organization. Sri Kiran Kumar, sir, is born on October 22, 1952, in Hasan, Karnataka. He is a MSc degree in Physics Electronics from Bangalore University and M.Tech degree in Physical Engineering from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He has steered the implementation of the applications-oriented Indian Space Program, which has facilitated rapid development of the country in many important spheres of Earth observation, communication, navigation, meteorology, and space science, as well as the development of indigenous launch vehicles and related technologies for providing assured access to space. He has led design and development of more than 50 of electro-optical imaging sensors flown on various space-borne platforms, starting from Bhaskara in 1979. Further, his role in the success of Chandrayaan-1 mission and Mars Orbiter mission has been significant. Sri Kiran Kumar has been the chair of the Committee on Earth Observation Satellites in 2012. He has made valuable contributions to coordination group of meteorological satellites expert team on satellite systems for World Meteorological Organization and Indo-US Joint Working Group on Civil Space Cooperation. Sri Kinkumar is the President, Aeronautical Society of India, and Fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, National Academy of Sciences, India, Indian Society of Remote Sensing, Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering, Indian Society of Systems of Science and Engineering, Indian Meteorological Society, Indian Society of Geomatics, Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences, and an elected member of International Academy of Astronautics. He has been confirmed with honoris causa and DSc by 18 academic Indian academic institutions. He has co-authored 85 publications in various international and national scientific journals. In recognition of his contributions, he was conferred Padma Shri by the President of India in 2014. Other notable honors conferred on him include Rajyotsav Award by 2015, the M. Visveshwaraya Senior Scientist State Award in 2013 by Government of Kerala, Karnataka, Lifetime Achievement Award from Karnataka Science and Technology Academy, IASC Distinguished Alumnus Award in 2015, Gujarat Ratna Life for Innovation Award conferred by Gujarat Innovation Society, Lifetime Achievement Award by Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences in 2016, Bharat Ratna C. M. Visveshwaraya Centenary Award by University of Mysore, GM Modi Science Award in 2016, H.K. Firodia Vignan Ratna Award in 2017, ISRO Lifetime Achievement Award in 2018. He has been conferred with the prestigious 2018 International Von Karman Wings Award, issued by the Aerospace Historical Society together with the Graduate Aerospace Laboratories at the California Institute of Technology in 2018. And the Xavier D. Orde National De La Legion D. Honor, the highest civilian honor by the Government of France in 2019. More than all, he is an excellent scientist with a human touch and always pursues with enormous patience what he thinks is best for the country and the people. Such a person we have today to deliver the 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Lecture. Sir, on behalf of IAST and the committee here, I request you to kindly deliver your talk.
Thank you, Krishnamurti, and good morning to all of you. Dr. B.N. Suresh, Chancellor of the Institute, Dr. Somnath, Acting Director, Dr. Y.V.N. Krishnamurti, Registrar, members of the Governing Board, faculty members, students, ladies and gentlemen, and participate from the industry. It's indeed a matter of great privilege and honor to be delivering the 7th lecture of a series in memory of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. While all of you are quite well aware of the great personality of Kalam and his association with the Institute, I would still like to narrate some aspects of his personality and some of them which I came across during my recent interaction with some of the people. My own interaction with Dr. Kalam has been, maybe you can count it, it's maybe about a dozen times, couple of them while receiving awards from his hands, and few of them, the professional interactions on the occasion of Chandrayaan 1 moon impact probe descent onto the surface of moon, and another just prior to the orbit insertion of Mars orbiter mission, while briefing him and subsequently briefing him on the activities of ISRO. What I learned about him in the last few days is worth recounting here. While we are all quite familiar with his simplicity and his approach, giving all that he received to museum sent for this, seed for this was sown when he was a young boy. His brother, who was relatively elder to him, was a corporator in Rameshwaram. One day, when his brother was not at home, somebody came to his house, and Kalam, who was about 7 or 8 years at that time, received from this stranger a packet to be given to his brother when he comes home. Kalam innocently gave to his brother on his arrival the packet that had been given to him by the stranger. His brother opened the packet, and on seeing that it was silverware, he became very angry and even slapped Kalam and told him that never to accept anything from people on his behalf. And he also told him that he was a corporator to serve people and not receive gifts from people. This had a lasting impression on Kalam, because otherwise his brother was extremely loving Kalam, and this was the first occasion where probably he showed his anger by slapping him. And subsequently, we all know that even when he was in the president's house, how he stayed, and we are told that he was just carrying only 2 suitcases ready to vacate the place anytime. This was one of the interesting episodes which I came across just a couple of days back, whilst one of the persons who is actually doing translations for Kalam whenever he comes to Karnataka, he was actually explaining his experience with Dr. Kalam and talked about this. Another very interesting episode was in the early 80s, Kalam was part of a mission where they, as a team, were trying to build a capability for a defense aircraft for carrying heavy loads while flying at high altitudes using solid rocket motors fitted to it. Now, both Kalam and C.R. Satya, they were on this mission. They had gone to the place, a high altitude location, where they had to fit this rocket onto an aircraft. And at the time of actual flight, a young pilot got into the aircraft. He took off, and both Kalam and Satya were watching the takeoff and beyond that from tarmac. And as the flight took off, and on a remote control, the rockets were fired, and it appeared to Kalam that the fire was almost engulfing the plane, and he was naturally very much perturbed at that point of time. Very soon the plane disappeared, and they were continuing to stare at the sky. After what appeared to be a long time, they saw in the distant sky a plane returning, and it safely landed. Young pilot stepped out from the plane, and without saying anything to Kalam and his colleague, went into a building. After some time, both Kalam and his colleague were called into the meeting that ensued, and they were congratulated for the excellent performance of the rockets on that occasion. Another very interesting interaction I had in relation to Kalam was when I participated in a program in Delhi, where one of the books written by Dr. Kalam, on the name of the book is Ascent, this book was being released from the organizers of Swaminarayan Institute. And on this particular occasion, the comparison of Dr. Kalam was with the person who actually started the Swaminarayan program, and the spiritual aspect of Kalam's life was very much evident. And then Kalam, like a typical, you can say, Indian, was accepting the role of guru in his life and in his pursuit of spiritual activities. And in fact, he had accepted one of the Pramukhanand Maharaj of Swaminarayan group as his spiritual guru, and then he also has told on many occasions that it was at his bidding that Kalam decided to actually enthuse almost about a crore young minds of India traveling widely within the country across very remote places and talking to the school students and then igniting their minds. And I also had an opportunity to visit his brother who lives in the ancestral place of Dr. Kalam and had an opportunity to have lunch with them and saw the very humble manner in which that family had come up and the great son of the soil. And when Dr. Kalam passed away, when we were traveling in different parts of the country, we could see that the remotest part of the country also was actually grieving the passing of A.F. Dr. Kalam. In fact, in the entire country, this one soul could evoke so much of emotion and response from the countrymen is a great tribute to what Kalam did and stood for in the country. Now, I believe, so delivering this 15th Foundation Day celebration of the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, for which he also happened to be the chancellor, is indeed a great privilege and an honor. Now, celebrating successful completion of 15 years is an appropriate time to introspect on the last 15 years' activity, critically analyze and see how we have performed, and also look ahead and set targets for the Silver Jubilee year. I'm very happy to learn that this Foundation Day celebrations has incorporated many features of bringing in student community, industry, and various centers of ISRO in the deliberations. And I need to compliment the Chancellor and Dr. Krishnamurthy for working out programs with Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology and set up. This was, of course, set up when there was difficulty in getting competent people in certain disciplines. And starting from that time, what the Institute has achieved in the past 15 years is a matter of great pride and actually happiness. But again, it does not mean that we have achieved everything that we want, but there is a lot more to achieve as things progress. What I intend to do in the subsequent portion of my talk is looking at quickly ISRO's journey, how it has come and where it stands today, and also look at how the world is looking at space systems and space technology, and then probably look at some of the aspects of how we should look and go ahead further. As probably all of you are quite well aware, but still I believe it's important to go through this particular aspect of how ISRO has performed over the past 5 to 6 decades and how it has grown. It is Dr. Vikram Sarabhai's vision that when a new technology of space became available, using such an advanced technology was an essential component in his mind for bringing in rapid development within the country. And it was his vision and foresight which enabled India at that time. You can imagine, just 10 years after independence, for a country, a fledgling democratic country, struggling with various aspects of governance and then providing the people the necessary inputs and the wherewithal for living. The technology of space, which looked very elite, if it had to be accepted by the government, it really required some convincing, and it was Dr. Sarabhai's effort which brought this and made it happen. So in the very first activity which was planned, in a, which made the impact to the government, was when ISRO made use of the advanced technology available from USA, a satellite which was going to beam broadcasting signals using a very advanced payload at that time. It was Sarabhai who convinced the NASA that they should allow India to borrow this satellite and move it over Indian longitude for about a year, and through that demonstrate in the country the power of communication reaching out to the entire country. You're all quite familiar, in the mid 70s, if an alternate technology were to be used, you would require one microwave tower every kilometer and almost 3.5 million square kilometers of the country would have required a huge number of such towers and terrestrial transmission system for reaching out to the entire country. And what was demonstrated in 75 was an example of conducting the world's largest socio-technological experiment in 2,400 villages, showcasing that using space technology, you can reach out to the farmers and the villagers. And that is what paved the way for INSAT series. And there again, the innovation of using broadcasting, meteorology, and communication, all three in one, to avoid use of three independent satellites and three launches, was the innovation that ISRO adopted for this. Similarly, in the area of remote sensing, if you look at what ISRO did, was to start with Bhaskara satellites, which was actually provided for by Russians as USSR cooperation. They offered to launch a couple of satellites. ISRO made use of it in building the satellites for remote sensing and demonstrated the capability. And very soon, ISRO started developing its own satellites for remote sensing, and then actually made its mark when in 1995, it was in the civilian domain, produced an imaging system which had the highest spatial resolution, better than factor of two better than the best available at that point of time between 95 to 99. And then you're also familiar that ISRO went on to build the remote sensing satellite, starting from a 1 kilometer resolution, coming down to a meter and sub-meter resolution. Today you have a host of remote sensing satellites providing observation capabilities, both from GEO, LEO platform, and then providing very high temporal, spatial, and spectral resolutions. Similarly, ISRO also adopted the innovative approach of providing navigation capability, both with Gagan and then subsequently Navik satellites, which is only a 7-satellite constellation in place of 24 to 32 adopted by others. Though our own constellation is catering to the restricted subcontinent of India or beyond Indian boundaries, about 1500 kilometers, that is the national prime requirement. And today, using the remote sensing and the navigation capability, fishermen is being provided with a small gadget which is handheld and battery operated, and that linked without a terrestrial tower, using the satellite signals from Navik, it's able to communicate with the mobile held in the hands of the fishermen, and this operating in communicating with the fisherman in his mother tongue, telling him about not only the place of his where he can catch the fish, but also giving him instructions about any weather vagaries that could occur, or even about the international boundaries, he's approaching that to warn him. So here is an example of what Dr. Sarabhai had promised when he started the experiment in Tumba Beach, that convincing the fishermen to vacate the place for conducting the experiment. 99 onwards, we were able to provide to the fishermen We have a 7,500 kilometer long coastline and providing to the fishermen information about where to catch the fish. And currently, with a small gadget, an illiterate person who does not have the capability of reading or writing can actually make use of the most advanced technology of launch vehicle, satellite, and application system. And this is a example of how ISRO has delivered, whether it is cyclone warning or providing inputs to the government in terms of governance activities, a host of them it has done. And it is also moving ahead, bringing in the human space program activities. And apart from that, currently ISRO is gearing up itself for enabling the community within India to become part of the global space economy. We will see some more details during the course of this talk further. So ISRO, starting with a simple sounding rockets, has developed technology of launch vehicles. It has done polar satellite launch vehicle, more than you can say 50 successful launches, and then using PSLV, a wide variety of activities, including without a cryogenic engine, putting a satellite into geostationary transfer orbit, putting satellites into moon transfer orbit, Mars transfer orbit, then also putting 104 satellites in one go. Like this, it has built many capabilities. Similarly, GSLV capabilities are all quite familiar. And so today, ISRO is trying to gear up for enabling both the industry and the academic institutions across the country to become part of the space economy of the future. So while ISRO has been building this capability in the country using the meager resources what was provided by the government, just to give you some idea, if you add up all the money that ISRO has spent till today, including the upvaluation or revaluation of the money on today's economic terms, this entire sum forms a fraction of what USA spends in a year. And this is less than what a yearly expenditure of countries like Russia or China, etc. So using such meager resources is what has been achieved. And of course, the more resources, if it were available, probably much more could have been done. But then we do understand that India as a developing country has its constraints for economic resources. And this is where globally India is recognized, that on a shoestring budget, what it has made use of in space technology is actually very noteworthy. And people are actually trying to emulate in some ways what has been done here. Just to give you an idea, after the Mars mission of ISRO, the Gulf countries started looking at space missions. And you have also seen that one of the countries has actually done their Mars mission as their first space program. So the kind of enthusiasm that it could create, the Mars mission, interplanetary mission conducted on a very small budget using the PSLV as a launch vehicle, et cetera, has been quite well known. But then today, if we see how things are progressing globally, while we have done all this, initially, it was only the governments which were actually operating the space programs, and the industry was actually being tasked to perform. And in the European country, Europe, actually the major portion of the developmental work was being done by in the industry through the funding provided by the governments. But still, all the space program itself was planned and then operated through the space agencies of the governments. But then in the last two decades, you have seen how the private entities are becoming bigger and bigger players. And today you have seen, for example, Elon Musk has developed a capability of space technology, which is very, very, you can say, noteworthy, and the speed with which the whole activity has been done is actually a really remarkable one. While the initial years, many of the attempts what they made, first four or five attempts, were not successful. Probably if one more attempt had failed, maybe he would have been rethinking on his missions of space program. But then they succeeded, and today he has shown that even the humans are being taken, and America is actually making use of Elon Musk's transport system for taking people to space station and bringing back. And not only that, ferrying cargo, and then the space, Elon Musk is actually building new launch vehicles which could take humans to Mars and also launch large number of satellites. And they have already beaten the record set by India of 104 satellites in one of the recent launches. And the manner in which he is going ahead building the launch vehicle technology capabilities and also the other capabilities in terms of communication satellites, etc., is making a huge impact. And not only Elon Musk, there are also a large number of others, whether it is Virgin Galactic, Jeff Bezos, or Boeing, etc., etc. They are all investing and going. See, for a long time, space was actually what you can call as space economy. Space economy was all about space for Earth. That means from space, what you are doing, which is necessary for humanity on Earth, whether it is for monitoring weather, providing inputs to the weather modeling, or climate change studies, or governance activity, monitoring and planning, resource planning, or communication, effective communication, navigation, all of this was primarily for, you can say, space for Earth. But then a lot of activities also is now taking shape in what is being called as space for space. That means you are looking at activities of using space systems, do things in for things happening in space and beyond space, including habitats on Moon, habitats on Mars, or mining, asteroid mining, or mining on the other planets, etc., etc. That means space for space economy. As you can easily visualize, space for space economy had not taken off till recently for the simple reason that the commercial viability of that space for Earth, still there is a significant commercial activity that can go on, because even when you want to create what is required for humanity is primarily staying on planet Earth. But as the future develops, as the future starts seeing more and more humans getting into space, both for space adventure or space tourism, or even space staying in space habitation, the requirements of the humans themselves and also in providing for their survivability in space becomes more, and people are looking at how space for space activities commerce can actually grow in the coming years. Probably you're all familiar what is talked of as $350 to $400 billion economy of primarily space to Earth itself is going to become almost space to Earth in by 2040 of something like $1 trillion or more. And then if you add to that space to space economy, it's expected that this could go to a very much higher and order of magnitude numbers. In the recent past, we have also seen that the private enterprise is really gearing up in providing a lot of services. See, for example, earlier, the satellite building, whether it is a satellite building large satellites or mini, micro, or even CubeSats or nanosats, etc., was all the entire satellite building was happening. Today, there are companies which are actually have taken off and ready to offer that they will provide you the satellite in orbit, they will provide you the ground station, they will provide you all the requirements that you need. You only make a payload and all the outputs of that payload will be delivered to you on your laptop or in your whatever room through connectivity. You don't have to worry about anything about rest of the thing. So they are ready to provide you this as a service. And it is not a very distant thing. It is actually taking off and happening in the just next couple of years. And they are already, the companies have established, they have worked out their business models and they have got orders and they are progressing on that. Similarly, see, you also would have been hearing that the launch on demand requirements of various users of different categories. Today, what is being actually talked about and being provided, and this again is becoming a service, is satellites are actually placed in orbit and in space. And instead of on demand, somebody deciding to launch, design, develop, launch from ground, it's actually the satellite is operating, is orbiting in space. So in a matter of a few hours to few days, it can do the job you want to task. And then such many satellites are in hibernation in space and they can provide you the service that you want. So this is another kind of service that is being talked about. And then of course, the industry of actually providing service to a large number of defunct space objects, which could be actually re-energized and then made operational, is another industry where huge amount of scope is going to exist, where both because of space situation demand and also decluttering the space becomes a necessity. You are quite familiar how things have progressed. For example, if you take in remote sensing itself, in the initial years, you had a couple of satellites or a series of satellites operating in a common orbit, though the functionalities of them are very different, constellations, etc. They were few in number, maybe up to 9 or 10. But then very soon, today, for example, you are aware, a company by name Planet Earth is providing 200 plus satellites, which is actually collecting data over the entire globe at 9:30 a.m. in the morning. And they can provide information to anybody on the basis of this daily collection of multispectral data and a huge amount of whether it is machine learning based or change detection based or artificial intelligence based inputs to a variety of users on ground. And this is being provided. In fact, we ourselves launched from our PSLV more than 100 satellites for them during the course of our own PSLV activities. Now, similarly, in the communication area, you have seen that initially what was there for DTH and others for communication, geo platform was the one which was going on. And then the requirement of very low latency signals drove the system for LEO constellation. And today, Elon Musk has already put a large number of satellites, almost reaching 1,000 in orbit. And he is planning in the ultimate analysis, something like 40,000 satellites in operation in orbit to provide internet for anybody on the earth. And you can imagine the kind of growth that is happening and the kind of complexities that are required for dealing with such large number of cooperating objects, trying to hand over signals from one satellite to another satellite, beaming it down to earth, and then coordinating with the ground station systems. You can see the phenomenal complexity that is growing in this. And then apart from the communication for this 42,000 plus satellites, there are also going to be large number of other challenges where For example, today people have started doing manufacturing in space. See, for example, a wrench was actually made for the use in a space station. And then actually a large number of, even NASA has given a contract for building large beams, I section, C section beams for infrastructure construction in space. So you can also see building in space can reduce the actual kind of carrying from space to ground, I mean ground to space. It reduces the cost of transportation and many more such things. Even building such 3D printing systems in orbit and then manufacturing things and zero gravity, etc. Though it has been talked about for many decades, the takeoff time is expected to be now, and the investment by investors, angel investors and others, is actually taking off and is on actually you can say explosive trajectory in the coming decades. And it's not very far that many of these things become operational and in use. So in this manner, not only the space tourism and space adventure, also you have already seen just in the last few weeks that totally untrained or any civilian, for example, he can experience few minutes of zero gravity thing by going up to a space that is just beyond the Kármán line and coming back. And then this is going to become a tourism space adventure activity. More than one company has already started doing it. And then earlier also, for example, parabolic trajectory activities for space adventure was going on. And then there is going to be a large number of such things going on. So apart from whatever is happening, both in terms of space for Earth and space for space economy is going to grow into a huge thing. Now, while all this is happening, now it's time for us to look at both within the country, what needs to be done and how it needs to be done. And then the role of institutes like Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. We all need to really look at how we should actually make the best use of the resources that you people have and how this intellectual resource can be actually taken advantage of in not only enabling the country to become a very significant player in the space economy which is going to become, like we are talking about, maybe trillions of dollars in the coming decades, unless we come up with some very concrete short-term, medium-term, and long-term approaches for dealing with this topic of how India can make use of space technology in growing as a country and also getting a significant portion of the global space economy. Today, we are told we are just at 2% of this economy. And if in future things have to happen, how can it happen? And what are the areas in which we should work? And you are all quite familiar that whether you talk of the new many of the capabilities, what has come, it has come in different areas. If you look at, just to take a few things, if you look at actually propulsion, which is one of the key things in the area of space technology, because you need to take things from ground to space. And if you need to take things from ground to space, you need these propulsion systems. Today, while we have built systems using the first stages with primarily solid motors as the components, solid stages as a component, this you can easily visualize that any reusable launch vehicle, if you want to do use of solid motors, is not going to be that much actually attractive, because when you bring back what comes in, this is only a motor, whereas if you bring back the engines, only by filling the fuel on that, the engines, the liquid engines, etc., can become much more effective, and also clustering them and using different propulsion system. Today, the capability of these chemical propulsion, even at the best of its ability, is probably can take you to maybe between 10 to 20 kilometers per second. At these speeds, reaching Mars would take many months. So obviously, when you are looking at interplanetary or for travel, you need to bring in velocities which could be, if not 100 kilometers per second, thousands of kilometers per second, at least you should reach something between 100 to 200 to start with and go much beyond. So beyond chemical propulsion, you already have electric propulsion, then nuclear propulsion. And of course, beyond that, if you are looking at today, as you can easily visualize, anything that you need to carry from ground as a fuel is a burden. So are there ways by which we can make use of space itself as a resource? This also as an idea, if you think that today we are told that the dark energy or the universe has a huge amount of 80% plus unknown energy staying. And as the quantum mechanics and also the knowledge of how from everything comes out from shunya or vacuum, the particles coming out of that for a few minutes or seconds, etc., a few milliseconds, the things are being talked about. Are there some ways by which this mechanism of whatever particles that can come out of this deep space itself being harnessed, in which case you can use that energy in some ways and in resonant form? These are, of course, there are many ideas which are floating around. But then when institutions like yours looks at, there should be some people who should be thinking about this, who should be looking at these aspects as a long-term research, and then conducting some meaningful experiments, even on a priority basis, which may not give us results today, but over a decade, over a few decades, it could showcase some ways. So one of the things is looking at how to harness energy from space itself could be a point under consideration. So similarly, if you look at beyond that, using space for actually power generation, all that, of course, today's economy of taking things from ground to space is what is limiting harnessing the solar power to the thing, restricting. But as the economy or as the technology evolves and the ability of conversion and ability of transportation becomes more and more attractive, things will change. So in this manner, there could be many, many things that one could keep on talking about. But what I would only say is that today things are very exciting. The government is also trying to look at how we can enable institutions, both the academic institutions and industry, to work together and move ahead and bring to the country a capability where India can become a significant player in space economy. And not only that, whether by adopting newer technologies or technologies on which people are not working today, can we identify and look at something? This is where the innovation, what the country has adopted by the visions of visionary leaders and who showed the way, and a large number of foot soldiers who converted their visions into practice. If ISRO has demonstrated that to the country and to the world today, the future generation within the organization and in the country have to look at how we can make it happen. In this context, I also would like to give you a small story which is of great interest, particularly when we are looking at academia and industry and how academia and industry should work together to bring this into a great harness. All of us are quite familiar with the story of the hare and tortoise. probably I don't see anybody not hearing the story. We all know that there was a race between the hare and the tortoise, and the hare, which ran the initial portion of the race very quickly, decided to take some rest below a tree, and then thought that this tortoise is going to take a lot of time, so let me take some rest below the tree. So it started taking rest, and then it fell asleep. By that time, the tortoise went ahead and reached the target, and then tortoise won that race. So we are told the moral of this story is study the effort wins the race. Slow and steady wins the race was the moral of this story. But then now this story has been modified and this story has been taken forward. So how it goes further is, now the hare started thinking, okay, why did I lose? I did not perform to my potential. So because of that, I lost. So it anyway went to the tortoise and then again requested, can we run the race again? So tortoise graciously accepted. So this time, hare did not stop anywhere in between. It simply ran full course with high speed and then reached the target. Now the moral of this story is obviously, if you perform to your potential, you can achieve the target. Now, by this time, both the hare and tortoise had become actually the friends. Now tortoise started thinking, hare is anyway moving at such high speeds. What is the mechanism by which I can beat it? Is there a way I can beat the hare? Anyway, tortoise comes up with a very novel idea, and then it asks the hare, can we run a race again? The hare says, oh, absolutely no problem. I am ready to run the race anytime. Now, but tortoise says, this race will be as per my target setting. The hare says, absolutely no problem. Okay, they start the race, and then the race involves a river in between. Now the hare reaches the beginning of that river and it doesn't know what to do because the target is on the other side of the river. Now the tortoise slowly trudges along, comes to the river point, gets down, crosses the river, goes to the other side and reaches the target. So now the moral of this story is, if you identify your capabilities and if you plan your activities according to that, you can perform better or you can achieve certain kinds of targets. That means you know your potential and you also plan according to that. But like I said, both the hare and tortoise had become friends by now. So now hare and tortoise decided to run the race together. Now hare carried the tortoise till the beginning of the river. Tortoise carried the hare to take it across the river, and then both of them again, hare carried it to the target. Now, by cooperating together, they achieved the target much faster. This entire story was created at a time when Coca-Cola and Pepsi were fighting for the target of beverage market. And they decided, instead of fighting with each other and then spending a large amount of money, how can we work together and then achieve? They decided to actually work together and in some ways fight for that common beverages market and achieved success. So here it is, if you look at, probably I don't have to tell who is the academia and who is the industry, but if academia and industry decide to work together, no target can be small, and then the target what India wants to achieve of achieving in this space economy, becoming a significant player, can be a reality. And I'm sure every one of you, with your ability to think, your ability to actually visualize, if you can come up with ways and means by which Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology actually plays a role in formulating its approach, both for midterm, short term, midterm, and long term, we could actually see a great role being played, where you have the opportunity to harness the young minds, you have the opportunity to harness the industry, and then through that become a guiding light to institutions like even ISRO for how it could actually perform in future. Some of the mechanisms could be like, this is one of the thing what I was trying to tell, a mechanism where you could actually look at different technology areas and you could come up with mechanisms which are run over a period of years. For example, in one particular discipline, if you want to see how things are happening, you have mechanisms of people, students and the academia finding out how the technology trends are happening, maybe conduct national and international symposiums, which are actually repeated once in few years. And then at the end of that, coming out with some guidance. And each year, it could be on a different topic. So it could be, that's just an idea you could think of in many different ways. Another thing could be, in fact, this is another area which is of interest, creating models for the activities that are performed. I'm sure many of you have come across the problems that ISRO has faced in its technology development. And many times what ISRO itself does will be working out a solution to the problem, which will be just sufficient for meeting the timely targets. Many times the solution adopted may not be the most optimal or the best solution, but as long as that solution can be demonstrated by a set of testing requirements, meeting the conditions of a test requirements, that methodology will be adopted and it will go ahead. And then that will becomes a heritage and moves on. But if there is a system wherein the modeling theoretical basis is done and then the problem solution and it is showcased, then in future system, such things can be adopted. A very good point in hand could be how the recent SSLV or other solid motors, the way it is designed, how it performs in the actual operation, that the CFD requirements, not only just fluid dynamics and thermal, but also even incorporating mechanical forces, mechanical erosion, etc. Can we come up with models and even bringing out such models, develop our own software and also make use of these, whether we can conduct those experiments in our laboratory using scaled down miniature solid rockets, which can be tested not in a very big test facility, whether these are scalable to such miniature sizes. These are all problems which could be actually addressed by institutions like this. So the one is with respect to model, whether it is in the area of propulsion or whether it is the area of even quantum computing. Today, you've already heard in the country, quantum technology country is going to spend a significant amount of money and resources across the institutions, and in what way things can come. If nothing else, institute can look at what quantum technologies can be doing for future aerospace activities or even future things. Could be another area. Here again, it's a modeling or using the software and to identify. Working in preparing use cases for AI and ML, already, like it was said, a lot of work is going on, but then can it be put into actual application and some of the activities which benefit what is happening, whether it is in the area of remote sensing, change detection, or so many other aspects, or even climate change. There are many aspects where AI and ML tools what you develop could become extremely useful. Quantum technology, I already talked about, both in terms of computing as well as developing, using that software could be an area of this thing. Then power from space actually could be another systems. And then the basic activities of space for space, in the area of space for space itself, are there some new aspects one could look at? Anyway, I can in principle go on and go on, but I think I have made my basic point that today, on the occasion of the Foundation Day, it is time for the organization to actually introspect, look at what were the targets we had set, how we met those targets, both in medium term and short term and long term. And not only that, did we have to change the course in between? As you can see, ISRO itself as an organization today is going through a sea change in the manner in which it is operating, because these are essential requirements of the country. Country is trying to become a multi-trillion dollar economy, and if it has to happen in all aspects of life, it has to grow. And our job is to guide this particular thing in the area of space technology, both with Space for Earth and Space for Space, and how we can do and make the best use of what mechanisms we have set up. If we have to do rethinking on what should be our target, and even having a mechanism to tell every now and then, by virtue of what we have done, that you need to change, you need to adopt this, or you need to look at these aspects. So let me thank Dr. Krishnamurthy and Dr. Somnath for giving me an opportunity to be part of this the Foundation Day celebrations, and also to be part delivering this lecture in fond memory of one of the great personalities of our time, a legend of our times, a soul who is going beyond science and technology, who is actually, in a way, the essence of the wisdom of our country, where knowledge we acquire should become part of how we need to use that knowledge for serving the society, the epitome of that, and also enthusing the next generation for future activities. So thank you very much, and also thank you for the patient hearing. Wish you all a great success in your efforts in the coming years and decades. And Silver Jubilee is the next target you should set and start working for, how to do, what to do, by that time, what to achieve. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your very simple words, talk, but then make it very big targets for all of us. Definitely, sir, we have noted down the points and agenda given to us, and we have a very young and dynamic faculty here. And together with the in collaboration what we are having with ISRO now, we will try to come out plans and come back to you, sir. And definitely your aim for us of Silver Jubilee, I think my professors will make it big, the type of challenging opportunities which are there. We'll go ahead with that, sir. That is assurance which I can give from the side of IAST. Now also, with your kind permission, we have also our chancellor. Maybe if Dr. Suresh sir would like to say a word. And also, sir, you are supposed to formally inaugurate our Foundation Day celebrations. So a word of inauguration also will kickstart our activities. Yes, sir.
Okay. So it's indeed a great privilege and honor to inaugurate the 15th Foundation Day celebrations, where the Institute has chalked up many activities as a precursor to this event. And what you are going to do following this is a great event. So wishing all the participants a great participation and experience during this event. And I formally inaugurate this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Suresh, sir, you would like to say a word, sir?
Thank you for the opportunity. You know, it was very thought-provoking and loaded with a lot of information. I think it was very useful for all the young faculty to know what ISRO has done in the last 5 decades, particularly in a wide range of activities, plus also what is in store for future. I think very nice inputs have come, and as you rightly summarized, you know, this is where we need to really harness the requirements that are available and then see in which direction we have to move. I think as an educational institution, it is important to see which are the areas that we need to lock on, which are the areas we need to take and then proceed. And particularly the long-term research, I think one has to really look at it very carefully. And when we do and come out with the solutions, I think they must be really of world class. You know, there is no point in doing something which has been done somewhere already. I think he has really given you the blueprint of which are the areas that one should look for. And also look, I think, elsewhere, what are the other areas we should really think about it. You know, many times what we think as the fiction becomes reality. I think we must become daydreamers and take it as a fiction and aim, which is one time finds it very difficult, but then it happens at some point of time. And I think as an institute, you know, this is our wish all along that we have been telling. The IAST should become world-class institution. And if we have to do, we also have to aim to look at the problems in that direction and work towards that. And today, the facilities also have to be built aiming to achieve the goal that we have set in. I think that way this has been a very excellent lecture, and you know, we couldn't have got any other person better than what he has delivered, particularly on the 15th foundation day. And thank you very much, Kiran Kumar, and I really enjoyed the entire lecture. So I think this is a definitely very good input to the all faculty members. I'm sure that they get motivated and they will take further, and wish all of you very best, and let us resolve that I think by the time we reach Silver Jubilee, some of them will be fructified, and then we really make our dreams come true. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. अब मैं हमारे डीन शाइशिकी डॉक्टर ए चंद्रशेखर जी को धन्यवाद ज्ञापन के लिए सादर आमंत्रित करूंगी. मैं इनवाइट डॉक्टर ए चंद्रशेखर डीन एकेडमिक्स टू प्रपोज द वोट ऑफ थैंक्स.
या गुड मॉर्निंग. इट गिव्स मी ग्रेट प्लेजर टू प्रेजेंट द वोट ऑफ थैंक्स फॉर द 7th डॉक्टर एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम लेक्चर. लेट मी एट द आउटसेट थैंक्स श्री एस किरण कुमार सर, फॉर्मर सेक्रेटरी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ स्पेस एंड फॉर्मर चेयरमैन इसरो and presently member Space Commission, for agreeing readily to deliver the 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture as part of the 15th Foundation Day celebrations of IAST. Sri Kiran Kumar sir dealt in great detail on the joyous journey and growth of ISRO in the last 5 to 6 decades, from starting from building of sounding rockets to building launch vehicles for low Earth orbit and geostationary orbits. Sri Kiran Kumar sir also underlined the important contributions of private industry and private players in the last 2 decades, notably by Mr. Elon Musk and his SpaceX program, as well as Mr. Jeff Bezos, as well as Virgin Atlantic and Boeing. These industries and players have made a significant contributions to the space industry in the last couple of decades. Sri Kiran Kumar sir also shared the rapidly evolving reality in the present scenario, in which any researcher only needs to build his or her payload and can hand over the same to a company that have their own ground station, their own launch vehicle, and so on. The company would then launch the payload and provide the data from the payload to the researcher at his or her end. So also Sri Kiran Kumar sir underlined the progress achieved in recent years towards space tourism and space adventure activities. Finally, he also underscored and underlined the importance of utilizing of IAST's intellectual capability combined with ISRO's strengths in contributing to the national space program in the years to come. I'm sure all of you would agree with me that the 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture by Sri Kiran Kumar sir was very, very illuminating and dwelt on all aspects and journey and growth of ISRO, and would motivate our young students, young researchers, and young faculty. I also take this occasion to thank our Chancellor, Dr. B.N. Suresh, for supporting our institute and for participating in our celebrations of the 15th IAST Foundation Day celebration. I also thank the various center directors of ISRO and Director IAST, Registrar IAST, fellow faculty colleagues and dear students for their participation in the 7th Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam lecture and getting benefited from the outstanding enunciation of ISRO's journey by Sri Kiran Kumar sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. सपने वो नहीं जो हमें सोते हुए जो हम सोते हुए देखते हैं, सपने वो है जो हमें सोने नहीं देते. डॉक्टर एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम के इस अनमोल वचन के साथ भारत को गौरवान्वित करने वाले महापुरुष को हमारा शत-शत नमन देते हुए आज का कार्यक्रम यही संपन्न होता है. ऑल आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू प्लीज राइज फॉर द नेशनल एंथम.
जय नमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता. पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा. तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा. जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता. जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे.
Once again, thanks to all for attending this lecture. We shall take a break and we'll meet in our afternoon session, IST Industry Meet Session 2, which will start at 2 p.m. Thank you.
See.